This is Healthy Souls with Father Nicholas Lowe, helping you to live a Christ-filled life in today's world. Father Nicholas is the pastor of St. John the Divine Greek Orthodox Church in Jacksonville, Florida.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you in church this morning on this 1st of November. So a blessed November to all of you. I'm grateful that you're all here. You're worshiping with us and celebrating the Divine Liturgy. You're here on the first day of the week. Sunday is the first day of the week, and so you're putting first things first by being here and celebrating all that God does for us every single day. And to those that are tuning in live, whether it be through our social media platforms, or if you're coming and watching us through our website or Saint on the Divine app, I know you have many options on what and where to watch services and who to pick from, and you just happen to choose Saint on the Divine today. Trust me when I tell you, we are grateful that you are doing that. And if this morning's message and sermon inspire you in any way, we just encourage all of you, do us a favor. Really try to do the world a better favor, and that is share it. Simply connect. If you're on social media watching this sermon downloaded, simply click the share button. Let's make a difference in this world. I also want to invite all of you to please stay connected. We have so many ministries throughout the week. They're all virtual. They're all online, whether it be youth programs, senior programs, Bible studies, children's Bible studies, everything that you could ever imagine. We have continued that all throughout this pandemic. If you want to get linked up to those different sites that have those types of ministries, please contact the church office. We'll take care of it from there and show you just how to do that. Today, I want to give you a little word of encouragement. This week's going to be a very long week for a lot of us. And I want to talk to you today about your acceptance speech. This Tuesday, November 3rd, Americans all over the country, if they haven't already, will cast their vote for either Donald Trump, the president, or Joe Biden. Millions and millions of people are going to go there and cast their vote. And hopefully, if it's not that night, hopefully over the next several days, we're going to know who truly is the next president of our nation. And whoever wins is going to get up on a stage and they're going to share their acceptance speech because they're the winner. Their words are going to inspire us. Their words, we're going to be hanging on everything that they say. It's going to speak a great deal of what's in their heart. Their words are going to be extremely powerful. It's their acceptance speech. In many ways, church family, we too are winners. We won when Jesus Christ endured the cat of nine tails, beaten 39 times. And the Bible says, by his stripes, you are healed. You're a winner. We win when Christ got on that cross, and we say in our divine liturgy that by his cross, joy came into this world. We are winners because when Christ rose from the dead in that tomb that was empty, we say all triumphantly, Christ is risen from the dead. He has destroyed death by his death. We are all winners. And as a result, church family, we too, every day, are giving an acceptance speech. We too, in our words, in our communications, in the way in which we act, are reflecting that winning mentality that God gave to you and to me. But if there's one area that I think Christians are truly struggling with, and sometimes in many ways may dismiss the power of, it is in the power of your tongue. I think sometimes we as Christians sometimes put our sins in categories. We think to ourselves, murder and infidelity is in one category. We may put lying in another category. Those are awful things we know. But we might say our words, yeah, they're not that right. They're not that good, but they're off to the side. They're a lesser extent of a sin. But in my research, church family, six of the greatest things that Jesus speaks about that he dislikes the most, three of those six things, listen to me, deal with the power of your tongue. The words that you're saying, the posts that you're posting, the emails that you're sending. Listen, we are shaping the world with our words. We are shaping this world with our words. I want to give you three things to think about, three Bible just hopefully encouraging messages, but also messages that I hope will challenge us. In the book of James, who we're going to do a sermon series on soon, James is one of these no-nonsense type of people. His writing speaks right to your heart. He doesn't kind of beat around the bush. He just kind of says it the way he feels. And he says it, to be quite honest with you, the way Christ is dictating him to say it. He says this in the book of James, chapter 3, if you're online, you can look this up as well as those of you here. Chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. He says, with our mouths we are praising God. You're in church. You're praising God. We're singing, God, holy are you, holy mighty, holy immortal. We're saying, God, you're an amazing God. You've done so much for us, thank God. With that same tongue, it says, we use it to curse our brothers and our sisters. With the same tongue that we say, God, you're great, is the same tongue that we use to hurt and curse our brothers. And listen to this one. This is a verse that I would encourage all of you to write down. It's kind of like the refrigerator verse of the week. It's James chapter 1, verse 26. And let me just encourage you, this verse is probably going to stomp on some toes, but it's the word of God. Listen to what James says. Does anyone think he is religious? Question mark. If he does not control his tongue, his religion is worthless. Let me say that again. If any of us, this great nation of America, if any of us think that we are a religious country, we are religious people, but you can't control your tongue, you can't control what you write, what you post, listen, it has consequences. It's not just I'm saying whatever's on my heart, I'm just going to share with it. No, what it's saying is that it is reflecting in your religion. Your actions impact your faith. Your religion is worthless. And Saint Theophon the Recluse, an amazing saint of our church that we celebrate in January, in talking about our acceptance speech, our words, says this. Remember that when you speak, you are giving life to your words, which once born can never die, but will continue to live on, listen to this, until the day of your judgment. They will stand right next to you. I don't know about you, but my knees quiver when I think about that. That all the words that I've ever said will stand right next to me. Everything that I post, everything that I email will stand right next to me at the judgment. And it will either speak, listen, for you, God willing, or it can speak against you. Our words, there's power in this tongue. Our words are shaping our world. And so today I want to give you just three tips. Three tips on how you need to write an acceptance speech and I need to write an acceptance speech every single day of our life. Here's number one. If these are helpful, write them down. If not, write them down. Here they go. Number one is this. Remember that your acceptance speech reflects what's in your heart. It's been said that out of the well comes the bucket. In other words, whatever is in the well will always come out of the bucket of your mouth. That's why Christ tells us constantly, constantly guard your heart, for everything will flow from it. If you want to know when you're looking at your life and you're taking an evaluation of how well I'm acting and how well I'm communicating to people, if I'm being complaining or if I'm kind of in a bad mood or if I'm depressed, listen, don't focus so much on your words. Look at your heart, because your heart is speaking through your mouth. And we have to recognize that if we're in a dark place, we will speak always in that dark place. We look at our country right now, people are wondering, gosh, can't we just stop talking so negatively on posts and on social media and the way we communicate, even amongst news broadcasters? Why? Because the soul of our nation is in a dark place. When the heart is in a dark place, the mouth will be in a dark place. What's the key to it? It's not some inspirational message you're going to get from a priest. It's not some self-help that you're going to get. It is the only way that you can get your heart in the right place is connecting closer to Christ. Our nation needs to connect closer to God, because you'll never be able to speak well to them if you're not connected first to Him. Like, we have to look at our hearts and make sure, God, I am living my life for You. I know that this election is going to come and go, and every day I have an acceptance speech. I want to dedicate my heart to You. You got to make sure your heart's in the right place, because if not, your acceptance speech will reflect it. Here's number two. So I have to remember that my acceptance speech influences everybody. Whether it's Donald Trump or Joe Biden, people will listen to what they're going to say. They're going to hang on every word they're saying. It's going to be influential. And you may not like who gets elected this weekend. That's okay. You're entitled to that opinion. You're entitled to that. But at the end of the day, those words that are going to come out of their mouths are going to influence us. And we have to recognize that our words are influencing people. Today we are celebrating the life of my dad. I tell people this all the time, that when I look at my own life, my mom and my dad were some of the most influential people in my life. Like, I look at my life right now, and my father, every day, didn't miss a day doing this, would always say, I love you and I'm proud of you. You could do this. He was always speaking faith in us. That was the influentialness that he had in my life, and I know my siblings and in my brother as well. I think about Miss Margaret, someone that all of us knew very well. Miss Margaret would always, every week when I would come and give her communion, would just simply pray over us. She had a tremendous influence. But if I was to ask you, what do you remember the most about Miss Margaret? You're not going to tell me that you remember how she had polio. You're not going to tell me how it was very difficult for her to walk around. But you will tell me the words that she put on a piece of paper, a card to you. You will tell me the words that she uttered out of her mouth. You see, her influence is living on far after she has gone on. Your words have power. They influence us. The people of Israel, after the Red Sea was divided, they literally saw the sea divided. Just imagine seeing the Atlantic Ocean divided. They would walk through that. Moses would come after that, when they were in the wilderness, would say to 12 men, represent the 12 tribes of Israel, go into that promised land and see if we can conquer it. 10 of them came back with powerful words. We can't do it. We are unable. 2, Joshua and Caleb came back and said, we believe that we can win. We believe that we can win. Those other 10 were so influential that Moses never went into the promised land. In fact, an entire generation of people who had just saw the Red Sea parted never went in the promised land. Why? Because those words have influence. Be mindful of the power and the influence of your words. And here's number 3. That when writing that acceptance speech, we remember that it's representing what's in our heart. And we remember that it has influence. But that we remember also, especially now, that our acceptance speech should have 2 main topics. Love and healing. We need love and healing in our nation. There's 2 times when God the Father speaks to Jesus. Only 2 times. We're sure that he spoke many times, but only 2 times mentioned in the Bible. 1 at the Transfiguration and 1 at his baptism. It's only 1 sentence, and this is what it says. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Translated to today's language, this is my Son, I love you, I'm proud of you. I look at my children, George and Gabriella. You are my children, with Roxanne. But you are my children, I love you, I'm proud of you. All of you saint on the divine, you are part of our church family. We love you, we're proud of you. If God the Father could speak to his Son to tell us that, how much more does our children, our husband, our wife, our friends, the world itself need to say, hey America, we are proud of you. We've come too far to allow ourselves to be divided. We are the United States of America. Don't we need some more love in our acceptance speech? And finally, healing. That we have a level of healing in our lives The Bible says a healing word can bring life to a world. Do you think that this country could use some healing? Let our words be healing. I leave you with this. 2020 has been an extraordinary year. You think about this pandemic. You think about the absolute political divide that we're experiencing. The racial unrest, the protests, the rioting. And I was thinking this past week as I was preparing this homily about this other big story, that the largest fires to ever hit our nation took place this year. 4 million acres singed. So you know me, I began to do some research, always looking for a message to share with all of you. They were doing some research on how one of the fires started that cascaded into the main fires. You know what started? Some man, innocent guy, was simply putting up his tent. He was putting a little metal peg in and he was hammering that little peg into the dirt. As he was hammering that little metal peg, a little spark came off of that little metal peg and landed. It kind of flew a little bit and then landed on some dry ground. And before you knew it, it lit up. It started to singe areas. It burned to the ground. Acres and acres of land, 4 million acres. That little spark burned the earth. In the same way, friends, sometimes we can think, that word doesn't bother anyone. It's not really impacting anyone. It's just saying it to a couple of people. That little spark is scorching the earth. And my encouragement for all of you is, watch what you're saying. That our acceptance speech needs to be words that reflect God in our heart. Our acceptance speech is to make sure that we remember that it influences people. That our acceptance speech reminds us that we all need to give words of love and of healing. Listen, church family, we are all winners. Now go out and make sure that your words change the world.
We invite you to join Father Nick and his wife, Dr. Roxanne Lowe, on the second and fourth Tuesday of every month for their Healthy Minds, Healthy Souls call-in show at 8 Eastern, 7 Central on Ancient Faith Talk.